Welcome everyone to the June 29th meeting of the Hadley Board of Selectmen. Call the meeting to order at 7 o'clock. First order of business is a consent agenda. I believe there's one item on here that we're going to remove, but we have the minutes from June 1st and June 8th. We have a vendor permit for Solar City. We have the appointment of alternate building inspectors, Tom Quinlan and Dave Wiskevitz. Appointment of an assistant collector, Kim Pfeiffer. We're passing over an electrical services contract award that will be taken up at a later select board meeting, I understand. Plumbing and gas services contract to Richard Watling, Plumbing and Heating. And Happy Valley Compassionate Care Charitable Contribution. Request the chief of police provide a list of suggestions of organizations that might receive charitable contributions under the Community Impact Agreement. And municipal electrical aggregation, approval of the aggregation plan submitted by Good Energy.
So moved.
Second. And just, didn't we have warrants that we signed downstairs? Do you have to name those or not?
We did have warrants that we signed downstairs. Do you have the numbers, or?
I do not have the numbers. I can go get the numbers.
Do we need to say the?
We can do those next meeting.
Okay. That won't be a problem?
That won't be a problem.
Okay. All right, thanks.
Why are we waiting on?
Point of discussion?
Yes, sir.
The one for Happy Valley?
Yes.
Now, that's only a suggestion. We're not voting to adopt that or anything, right?
Correct.
For that area.
Right.
It's just only a recommendation.
Correct.
Okay,
yep.
Fine.
And the thought was probably something we'd discuss with the planning board as well.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay. Anything else?
Where are we not doing anything with electrical?
We were checking the references on, as Mr. Bird was doing the references on the electrical low bidder for the electrical maintenance contract. There's some further diligence that we have to do, so we want to make sure that we're making an appropriate award. So
oh.
If we could have a little bit more time, that would be good.
That'd be nice to know.
Well, you can ask Mr. Bird. It's on our agenda, so motion and second on the floor.
I was just wondering who the contractor is. There were six contractors, if I remember correctly, six contractors who bid on the electrical maintenance for the town. We have a low bidder. We're checking the references. We want to make sure that we do our due diligence with respect to the low bidder, so that we can make a clean award.
Yeah.
All right, so we're going to just put this on hold for a little bit.
There was some confusion with some of the references that he gave. It took us a while to get a hold of somebody. One person had retired by the time, one person was on vacation, so.
Okay, so we've got a motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All except for the alternate building inspector.
Except for the alternate building inspector, okay.
Dan Wiskevitz is a relative, so I'm going to abstain from that one.
Could he speak up? I can't hear him.
He's abstaining
David
from...
David Wiskevitz is a relative.
His cousin.
So oh, okay.
I abstain from that one.
Fine.
Okay. All right. So now it's time for public comment. Do we have anybody? Yes, we do. I know we have one person. Marlo, our DPW director, is here. I believe you wanted to make a statement just to inform the public of some activity on Route 9.
Mm-hmm. Actually, I got three quick things. I don't want to take a lot of time, but just a couple of updates. First, I'd like to say thank you to the community and the taxpayer for the vote on the backhoe. I appreciate it, and certainly the department appreciates it. Again, thank you. Route 9, there's a lot of activity going on. We're about close to 70% done with the water work out here. Right now, the last 30% is going to be most of the heavy lifting, the new main being put in and retiring the old main, which involves shutting down lengths of main, which means customers and businesses go without water for a period of time. So far, we've had to shut down two or three times to do the work. We've done our due diligence to get the word out ahead of time. So far, I haven't heard any big problems with the shutdowns. I also wanted to get out there that when we tie the new main into the old main, just past the Farm Museum, that's going to be a major shutdown, and I'm working with the contractor now. It's going to affect all the way to Sears and a few businesses and houses off East Street. So I'm working with them now to either come in early when we make that connection or at night. I don't have a solid schedule on that yet. We're supposed to talk about it again tomorrow, but like I said, we're about close to 70% done. All indications that we're following within budget. We've made some good, really good changes to the system on the way. We have found things that weren't supposed to be there. We found things that were there, vice versa. So we've made changes as we've gone along. Few of them have been change orders. It's a few more bucks on our end, but it had to be done. We're hoping to wrap the waterworks up by July 13th. It's not a definite date, but the way things are going, weather permitting, we should be done by the middle of July. It actually worked out well that we're getting all our waterworks done first and then the road construction starts. I think the traffic congestion would just be compounded doing both at the same time out here. So it's actually worked out well with the gas company getting their start and then the contractor doing our water work. So far, so good. One other thing I want to put out there is our water plant's been pumping over 1 million gallons a day for the full month. We all know it was a dry winter. It's a dry summer so far. We're not at the point where we have to, you know, put out any kind of official conservation at this point, but we're keeping a close eye on it. We did 1.6 million last Sunday, and the plant's designed for about 2 million. So the plant's running fine. We don't have any problems there, but it's working pretty hard. So we need to look at it two, three more weeks if Mother Nature doesn't help us out here, because we may have to do something so we can get the pump shut down and do some maintenance on it, the maintenance that needs to be done. But so far, all the testing, the water's fine. So we're monitoring it very closely. As we lose any quality, we're going to have to do something to get the pump shut down. Or less use, so the pumps will shut down so we can do the maintenance, if you will. So we're monitoring it, and we'll let you know if anything comes up.
Okay, I know a couple of people have been asking about it, so yeah. It's good to know where we're at.
You know, the board, I spoke to you a little bit about it before last week, but the board gave them permission to work at night. If we're going to affect that many people on that end of Route 9, there's no possible way they can work one or two nights.
Yeah, I put on the table that they prepare that the day before, plate it. MassDOT is not real happy about plating the road for overnight because it's such a high travel road, but they're working with us. My thought was if we have it prepped the day before, they might be able to come in like at 3 in the morning. It'll give a little wiggle room and time so they can make that connection. So if it's not an overnight deal, it's going to be a real early morning deal, but I put that on the table with them, and that's what we're talking about now. So
and thanks to the entire DPW staff for just a huge endeavor, and everybody's stepping up and working hard, so we certainly appreciate it.
Our water crew actually has changed out a few things. The sewer crew has changed out a few things before the project started that would have been, you know, much more expensive for the contractor on the fly to replace a gate valve, stuff like that. And we've had our guys do it, and it's turning out okay.
Good.
So far.
Good. Do you have a comment or something else?
I got a question.
Yep.
Is it true that the utilities line is running on top of the sewer?
We caught that. The water work was not going on when they were laying the conduit, so it was brought to my attention that they were laying it over the sewer. And it's the best of my knowledge, they cut it and they moved it off our sewer.
It's
to the side of it now, yes. The problem with the whole, it's not a problem, but the project is very tight altogether. Everything got put on the north side. You have conduits, you have sewer, you have new gas main, you've got old abandoned gas mains, you've got a lot of stuff stuffed into that widened area on the north side. Not to get into all nuts and bolts, but I want to re-TV that section and possibly get it lined Even if the conduit isn't directly on top of it, we're still digging between many utilities. So I'd like to address that sewer line and bring it up to snuff the best we can so we don't have to address it in an emergency.
Yeah, there was a root problem with a couple of them we dug up. And once we dug them up and exposed them, that's when we realized we had a problem with the connections at the main when they were installed originally, so.
Okay, so thanks for the.
Yeah, I think John was present when they cut the conduits and they had to move everything that day.
Yeah, there's just a small portion of it still. Still, we don't know.
It is encased in concrete, so if we have to get to the main.
If we keep talking about like DPW parts, I'm going to start talking about finances.
That's okay.
For everybody who does this.
Sorry to take up so much time, but I wanted to make sure we got the.
No, it's important for everybody to know what the status is because again, a lot of folks are seeing what's going on and they want to know what's happening, so. Public comment?
Yes. I talked to this board, addressed them on several occasions about town common and business use in town common parking. I went to visit the building inspector. He wrote a letter for a violation notice, and that was stayed. It was Mr. Nixon, the police chief, and the fire chief. I want to know why does this board interfere with the planning board's decision when they put a site plan review? Are we going to expect this to happen to every place that we make a decision and Mr. Nixon is going to get involved in it and it's not returned back to the planning board? I went down there the other day, the parking from the road to the sidewalk. That's all town property.
Is it posted?
It's not posted, but they're violating the site plan review that the parking was not to park off the premises. They're off their premises.
So is this something that we can?
The town common belongs to the town. What don't you guys understand about that? I think this is absolutely ridiculous. I talked to Bill Dwyer and I would like to have the town council rule on this, that the selectmen, can they intervene and the town administrator in an order of the planning board?
My understanding is that we can't enforce something where there's no indication that, I mean, there's nothing posted there and plenty of other people. So, I mean, I think we should maybe have a bigger discussion about the town common and parking to find out if that's something we want to pursue. No parking signs all along our common or.
I think the past police chief was involved with it at one time.
What I had people say to me is the selectmen of Hadley covering this up for a business. Other businesses, we make them stand on their property. Do not overflow your parking on public land, public roads, and we want to enforce that. For some reason, it's a roadblock. Here's the letter, and it's on hold. Why?
Okay, so we'll take your comment under advisement, and we'll find a way forward on this to get an answer back to you.
I do have a comment on this, too.
This has been several months now. This goes way back.
Okay, well, but we're not going to resolve it tonight, John.
A month ago, we sent a letter to the building inspector requesting a reply back about that situation. We never even got the courtesy of a reply back. I went out there with Mr. Nixon. We counted 25 cars parked on the common. The next day I went back, there was 23 cars parked on the common. Mm-hmm. You know, today there was a major accident, probably because the view was blocked right there. Mm-hmm. And there was injuries in the accident. It's a very serious problem and we're letting it go. We made Subaru move a wall because they were too close to the road. At one point.
Right.
So we have to discuss this.
Yeah, absolutely, but we're not going to resolve it tonight. We don't have all of the parties present to discuss it. So again, it's public comment. So can you and I talk about getting it on an agenda, figure out again a path forward, who the appropriate parties are to discuss it?
Yeah.
Okay.
I got two other.
Okay, we're actually running over our public public comment period, and
well, you can't help it. The DPW director spent took all the time.
Can you hold your other? Can you hold your other?
You took it all last time, so I had
to. I did.
We do have an appointment scheduled, and we're running a little bit past already, and I believe we have some folks here from Northeast IT Consulting.
Yep.
Okay, so do you want to come forward and introduce yourselves?
Sure.
I'm Joel Mollison, President of Northeast IT Systems, and this is Gary Rivers. We're here tonight to review our five-year strategic plan that we handed in to you folks, I believe it was December or January?
January.
Okay. So we're here to answer any questions and discuss.
Okay, thanks for coming. So, and just by way of background, if I want to say it was in the summer of last year?
Yeah, we were actually over at the public safety complex, so it would have been July.
Okay. So one of the initiatives that the select board undertook was to, in listening to our town employees, we were finding that an underlying theme throughout all of the departments, regardless of what building they were housed in, was the state of the information technology available to them. And it came from a variety of issues, from hardware to software to bandwidth to, you know, wireless connectivity, printing issues, you name it. I mean, think about all of the typical office equipment one needs to function in today's world, and we were having issues with it. So rather than take a one-off approach and have the individual departments going out and trying to figure out what they needed for equipment, the select board authorized the hiring of Northeast IT Consulting to take a holistic view of the town, you know, across all of the town departments, and see if there were any common themes and make recommendations on any, kind of put it into different categories of what might be the proverbial low-hanging fruit. Was there some immediate benefit we might get spending just a few dollars? And I think we've already found that. Then, you know, concerns they might have about information security, things like that. Then kind of mid-range projects that, you know, may take a fair amount of money in planning. And then longer term projects about, you know, how do we get from where we are now into a far more modern and robust system. So, and the purpose of that was so that we could build that into our five-year strategic plan for the town. But we didn't want to wait, given the fact that it was obviously impeding the ability of our staff to perform at their utmost efficiency. So, kind of with that is background. So you've done a report. Looks like, you know, and you've gone department by department. You conducted interviews. So maybe it would be helpful to just get a quick, you know, how did you approach it, and then move into your general findings.
Sure. You're the one who did the most of the work, so.
You know what, from our perspective, I just want to give you a little feedback just to see if it helps, you know, in the future. I would love an executive summary on all the information that's here of the 98 pages that were there, so that we could, you know, take a quick look at it and then use it to research the rest of the document that we have here, and also with a funding mechanism at the end, so that you could say, here's the five-year plan that we think that you guys should implement, here's the funding mechanisms for it, here's the cost year by year as to where it would be and what the benefits are for it. I didn't see that in here, and it makes it a little harder for me to interpret the information that we have in the report in front of us.
Sure.
Okay,
sure.
Thank you.
No problem. And I'll discuss some of the issues that we ran into that kind of prevented us from doing that part.
Okay.
But our approach to this was, again, we didn't know that you guys had any documentation on the state of everything. So what we basically did is we went through every site, and we did kind of like an audit. We went through, took a look at all the systems that were there, all the, you know, infrastructure, the wiring, the networking, all the PCs that were there, the applications. We talked with staff to see what their common issues were. When they ran into issues, what was their approach to solve those issues? We also asked them, what are some tools that they think that they could use, or, you know, that they currently use to solve a problem, that type of thing. Kind of get an idea of how people are using what's there. And we went to all the locations, and we kind of found that each location, they kind of came up with their way of just surviving, just getting through with what they had. If a computer died, you know, there wasn't like planned replacements. It's just they got what they could. There wasn't a lot of planning for upgrading equipment or software, just things were as they needed kind of to be done. Some departments were in much better shape than others. You know, the police department, obviously, they had more of a budget and had an IT, a separate IT company that was able to, you know, have a much stronger network over there. Fire also had a pretty decent system set up. But we did find a lot of common themes, even in all those departments. And some of the common themes that we had are all the computers are individual. They're not managed as a system. So what happens is when you have these issues, a computer dies, a computer gets a virus, there's no organized plan on how to retrieve data from that. There's not even a clear source as to what the backup is across the board for all these, you know, different things. Some just individually copying to a flash drive, you know, putting it in the safe. Some of it used offsite backup. But the selections of the files that were, you know, backed up and things like that were not reviewed on a regular basis. So in some circumstances, people were under the impression that the computer was backed up when that we found that it wasn't the case. So it was kind of, overall, it was kind of just people fending for themselves. You know, they did what they could to get through the job. They came up with some unique ways of sharing files if they needed to, or just gave up on the idea of sharing files and, you know, printed it out and just, you know, talked about it in person or things like that. A common difficulty that was coming up is when they needed support, some people had great, you know, experience. They got it right away. Other people wasn't so good. And sometimes they, you know, they would do whatever they had to. So if it was a family member on the side that fixed it for them, or, you know, a spouse or someone that had a little bit of knowledge, that's just, you know, path of least resistance was kind of done to bring that up. Obviously, ideally, that's not great security-wise. You know, someone might have the best intention to fix something, but could leave a hole, or not knowing how everything is tied together might accidentally, you know, it's a common thing. You try to fix something, you don't know that it's tied to something else. Domino effect can make the problem worse. Overall, some of the things that we found were budgeting. No one had any idea for budgeting. Nothing was kind of really planned. Again, it was just as things broke, as things became huge emergencies, that's when they were addressed. There was no, okay, this computer is good for 5 years. You know, when it's done, maybe we can rotate it to this department because it's not as a, you know, primary use, things like that. There was no plan for that whatsoever. Use of buildings and, you know, are departments going to stay in the buildings? Are they going to move around? Again, a lot of those decisions or just information wasn't available. So it made it hard to say, okay, in this building, we need to put this infrastructure in, and then over time we can grow that. If the departments aren't going to stay in there, it's hard to say, okay, these years, this is what we're going to invest in, because, you know, that building might not be used. You know, an example is, you know, a couple of the buildings that are looking to be sold. You know, it's hard for us to make a 5-year plan when we don't know if, you know, you can even own the buildings in 5 years. There didn't seem to be a plan of acquiring or organization of acquiring equipment. It was either just quickly done through Staples or some people weren't even sure how the software was done. They just got there, or it was there when, you know, they started using it. Other people, again, just did whatever they had to do, whether it was personal money or found free solutions, that type of thing. And that's kind of how we approached it, was just to take a look at what's going on. We tried our best to collect information, again, on budgeting, to see where you were at so that we can recommend different approaches. So what we ended up doing when we realized that we were not going to be able to do that for you, we weren't be able to spell this out, year one do this, year two do this, what we did is we approached each individual building. We did it by building instead of by departments, again, because we don't know where the departments are going to move. So that's how we did it. So we, in our report, we go location through location talking about all the current infrastructure and our recommendations for, you know, assuming that building is going to be used in the same way going from there. So that's how we ended up approaching it and constructing the document. So, you know, example like the town hall, we went through that. We figured, you know, there were some security issues. Some have already been addressed. We figured the best bang for the buck would be to start there because it has the most departments, and it affects the most users. So we had a couple of recommendations, some things that needed to be immediately addressed in our opinion, security-wise, again, which have been addressed, such as the Wi-Fi, things like that. And then we went through all the other locations. And again, some of it's tough, like the DPW, they have trailers. You know, how do you make the recommendation to set up, you know, a physical network there? When are those trailers, you know, permanent? Are they going away? You know, is there a new building? Again, it puts us in a tough spot where we don't know if what we're looking at is really something that's going to be there 5 years down the road.
I'd just like to add that additionally, this is challenging because when you're dealing with a municipality, it's difficult because there's not often one decision maker, but there's multiple. And there are numerous ways to approach IT in a municipal environment. You know, whether you're talking about in-house server, whether you're talking about cloud, whether you're talking about voice over IP phones, things that are going to be merged and converged networks later on. Maybe you're going to join off-sites together with the town hall being a central point in the future. But all those little variations, they require somebody at some point to make a hard decision. And yes, I understand you need to know facts and kind of understand the basis of why you're making those decisions. But until you make those decisions, you really can't spell out a full roadmap in terms of expenditures, you know, budgeting for the future. And, you know, we probably could have wrote the executive summary, I'll give you that. But in terms of, you know, giving you a roadmap in terms of funding and budgeting, it's almost nearly impossible unless some key decisions can be made along the way. But like most municipalities that we work with, sometimes it's really difficult out of the gate to gauge who's going to make those decisions and when and how. And again, as Gary stated, the buildings are at the core of this. Mm-hmm. If you cannot make decisions about where folks are going to reside, it's really detrimental to creating any kind of plan, especially with the public safety. They have more equipment, they have more complex equipment, more complex security requirements. So the wiring and infrastructure needs there are going to be much greater than, say, the DPW. But again, if you're moving folks from building to building or not sure, it's really hard to even kind of consider, you know, the possibility. So unfortunately, what we were left with is Trenton giving you a broad range spectrum of costs. You know, it could be from here to there, but it really depends on some of the decisions in the middle. You know, and as you mentioned earlier, there is a lot of low-hanging fruit in terms of security issues, you know, internal issues. I mean, there's things you guys can do here with servers and policies and maintaining the network much more effectively and efficiently, and I think that was kind of the key, and that's really the starting point. And you can do that, you know, I would say if you could come up with a budget between $25,000 and $40,000, you could make a serious dent that would definitely affect a lot of folks here in this building, and that would probably get you on your way to, you know, a good start to building the infrastructure. But again, it goes back to some of the key things that I mentioned before about how you're going to, you know, do a backup system, what your risk tolerances are. We didn't really get that from you when we did this, so, because again, it's a collective effort. So every, you know, at some point you may have to have a committee or a subcommittee to discuss these things and break it down a little further so somebody can really kind of give you, you know, a more focused, you know, report on where you could go and what the costs associated may be.
So could you just talk a little bit, because you are in and out of other municipalities, mm-hmm. I mean, I think we're generally aware of the sorry state of our information technology here. I mean, I think you've hit most of the highlights. But, you know, obviously are desirous of moving it forward, if nothing else than for staff morale, because nobody wants to sit there, you know, taking 45 minutes to do something that should take two. Mm-hmm. So in that regard, you know, obviously we don't have a dedicated IT person in-house. Our school department does have one person that handles just the schools, but there's nobody on the town side, so to speak. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about how other towns handle information technology? Is it more common than not to have somebody internal? Are they outsourcing? How is it happening?
Yeah, most of the towns that we work with, and even regional councils of government, they don't have an internal person. a lot of it boils down to having good infrastructure, and when you don't, as in this case, you have a lot of little problems, which prevent your employees from getting their work done on a daily basis, and it ends up compounding. And the longer this goes on without fixing the general infrastructure, it continues to affect, you know, performance in all areas. So you don't really need an internal person, I wouldn't say, for this town. If you could get things cleaned up to a reasonable level, I think that outsourcing it is still the way to go for you. But you need to get to a point where you don't have so many tiny issues that are compounding weekly or monthly that are really detracting from fixing the overall network infrastructure. You guys continually, looks like you put Band-Aids on things, and Band-Aid after Band-Aid, and you're not really doing the surgery required. So, and that's really where it comes down to, doing the surgery, getting things to a reasonable level, and then just kind of maintaining that with the foresight, you know, to replace equipment, to do things, you know, in a fundamental way that you understand that there's going to be a budget and you're going to replace equipment and you're going to do things consistently moving forward. The problem is, a lot of municipalities, is the budgets also aren't always there. And we understand that, and that happens a lot. And if you don't follow through, what happens is things start to fall away. And then you get into the slump, and then what happens is things get to a point where you have to go out and get funding for a special project, do a very large project, and then maintain again until it falls off again. And we've seen that happen in many, many times.
So, I mean, I think one of the concerns I have is, you know, they've done this work. There are a lot of specific recommendations within each of the functional areas for buildings, but I mean, effectively the departments. Again, I think some of them, you've already started moving on replacing some of the routers or whatever here in town hall and that kind of thing. But there were also, you know, in the fire department, some concerns about, you know, security of information and things like that. So, would you agree, like, they, looking at the priority red or the number one items, however you have them labeled, would it be a reasonable approach to start there with the intent of, you know, maybe looking at a project-wide basis, trying to raise funding in terms of looking at the overall infrastructure? I mean, the building issues are starting, we're starting to see a little bit more clarity on the buildings, much more so than when you did this. We're that much further along, so I think that for some of the things that you needed to kind of defer an opinion on, we might be able to get our minds wrapped around the information technology solution for certain areas now. So, I mean, what does anybody else think?
I think on the SWAT information that we got from everybody, being able to communicate amongst the departments was an extremely important asset that we were looking to do, that people were, and, you know, four individual departments were trying to look at the exact information. One of them found it. Why should we do it four times? Why can't we communicate better amongst, in our communication system than that? Is that, that would be a priority for me to get addressed.
Yeah. And so that's, you know, file sharing within town hall here.
Right.
I mean, it's not a complex solution, right?
No, not at all. I mean, honestly, that's where I would start. I would start with the town hall. I mean, the police and fire, they already have servers. Whether they're configured properly, you know, or the best, you know, they do have the server, so at least the baseline is there. At the town hall, you don't have anything here. All the computers, like I said, are managed centrally. There's no way to implement password policies, file security policies, really nothing. You know, so I think, you know, that's where I would start. I would start, you know, here at the town hall, get a server, and then you can start linking up all the other locations. So again, you have sharing across the whole town, not just in the building, you know, but that's where I would start. But again, there are some decisions that have to be made. You know, how many people are eventually going to connect to the server? Is the plan to connect all the departments? You want to make sure that you get the right server and things like that. And I know you've already addressed some of the wiring, that would, you know, the issues here in the building. So I would imagine that the plan is to stay in the building, or it's looking that way?
Not going anywhere in the near term.
Okay. So, you know, and that was some of the concern. I know originally there wasn't a lot of wiring, so it was mostly wireless to, you know, to do that. So, I mean, you know, that's where I would start. And, you know, if you want to open up a separate project to figure out how big of scope that would be, you know, that would be probably the smartest place to start.
Okay. And that's what I was really alluding to when I mentioned the 25 to 40,000 before.
Yeah.
So I really think that could make a serious dent within this building, and that's the whole thing. And you have to understand that if you move fundamentally to a server environment from where you're at now, you really have to retool your entire environment in this building. That it's a very large project, and it's going to affect every single user. But once you do it, and that process is done, you really shouldn't have to ever repeat it again if it's done properly.
Does Hampshire County Advisory Board have an IT bid proposal?
The COG?
The COG, yeah. Or maybe that's something we could investigate, that they could do it, and it'll help out a lot of smaller communities with bid processing where you could get it much cheaper.
Are you doing anything on a county level? Or?
With Franklin Regional Council of Governments, we actually handle their IT.
No one is doing Hampshire Council?
I don't know if anybody does the IT for them.
They have a relationship with Paragus.
Right, they have through Hampshire IT, they have a relationship with Paragus.
Mm-hmm. And it's very
good. But is it a bid process where any community could use it?
It's not a bid process. It's not a regional bid process. It's a service that fee for service program for IT for small towns. But it's not a procurement avenue.
One of the problems you're going to face with procurement in this regard is that you really have to have a specified scope of work.
Yeah.
It really has to be kind of, the internal decisions have to be pre-made to some degree. I mean, you can talk to folks like us and consultants, but at the end of the day, before you go out to procure that bid, you really need to understand what you're trying to accomplish so you can convey that to the bidding parties. We've been a part of many, many bids before where there was just really a poor outline of the scope of work. People didn't really understand what they were asking for. Well, they did. They knew what they wanted the end result to be, but they didn't have the technical expertise to understand the variances. And we can discuss that, but again, until somebody makes an actual decision and picks that road, once you start down that road, there's no going back. You know what I mean?
But Joel, so one question was, what are other towns doing? And you said most of them really are outsourcing to a third party. Mm-hmm. But in order to get from point A to point B, you need the experience to figure out what it is you want. So how do they handle it? Via like an IT committee, volunteers from the community? How do they?
That's part of it. Some places have IT committees, and some of the folks are very bright, and they're in the IT field, and they understand it, and they will work with the administration, and they will work with the IT provider to, kind of go over the scope of work and the direction that the community wants to go in. We work with communities that don't want a server. They want to go cloud-based.
Right.
And there's pros and cons. And we work with communities that want to, stay with traditional server clients, which is what we, proposed here for Hadley. Mm-hmm. So it really depends. And again, there's variances on it, and you're not going to understand it all as a layperson. You're just not. Mm-hmm. And the important thing is to understand that, what the differences are up front and what the costs are going to be. But once you start down that path, there is no return because the expense is too great.
Right.
You're going to start and you're going to keep down that road. And the thing is, you really need to rely on your outsourced provider. Your IT provider really should be providing you with different variations of ways you could, go, and giving you, some kind of insight. I mean, they should already know what this network is all about. They should know, what you're trying to accomplish. And they should be able to provide you with some kind of feedback on which way is the most appropriate way to go, what the pros and cons are.
Mm-hmm.
But again, it boils down to somebody or some committee must make a hard decision.
Right.
And the IT companies just can't do it.
Yep.
I understand what you're trying to say, but how does it work for Franklin County now? You represent them. Is it on an hourly bid? Is that how you do it for anybody, in Franklin County?
Franklin Regional Council of Governments works a little bit differently. They work with their communities that are part of the FRCOG, just like you're part of the HCOG, I'm assuming.
Mm-hmm.
If folks need to go out to bid for something, Franklin Regional Council of Governments is very good at procurement in terms of IT. They have folks on staff who really kind of understand some of the intricacies of IT and which way they could go. So they really work with the towns to help write the bids for the towns. And then they go out. And we bid on these jobs. In fact, there's been several in the last few months that we've bid on that have gone through FRCOG and for towns specifically for things just like this. But FRCOG helps them with the process. And sometimes FRCOG will reach out to us and say, we have a town that wants to do this or that, and we'll give some pointers. Well, they could go this way or that way. And then, you know, the town ultimately, again, has to do some research, make some decisions, and decide before they put that bid together to go out.
So what you're saying, it's done all through a bid process, not an hourly process?
It can be done either way, but most of the time in the bid process, it's done, again, with the Band-Aid solution stopped working at the hourly rate, and you get to a point where you really have to do major corrective surgery, that's where the bid process really comes in. Because you're usually talking $25,000 plus projects that are really encompassing of multiple departments, multiple sometimes buildings or sites. You know, it could be a variety of different technologies. It could be backup systems, it could be servers, it could be network infrastructure, it could be a combination of all those things.
Does it eliminate the bid process for the smaller communities in Franklin County where it's already done through the COG?
It doesn't eliminate the bid process at all. What it does is just enhances it. I mean, it helps them understand what they're trying to get a bid on and the scope of work. So that actually helps the IT companies deliver in a more timely fashion. It means they really understand what you're trying to do at the end of the day. Thank you.
Any other questions from the rest of the board?
Any grant monies available for these things?
There's a
any expertise with that?
There's a community compact grant available right now. I don't know if Hadley's involved with that through Mass IT.
We are, but not through the IT portion of it.
Yeah.
Okay.
And there was, I know there was a lot of monies for that for infrastructure, and I don't know, is it just not, it's not available to you, or is it something you haven't pursued?
Are we available to adjust our priorities as far as that goes?
Yeah, they haven't started working on our projects yet, so we can take another look at it.
Be the best idea to possibly redirect,
or if we can tack it on, right?
Well, we were allowed two different venues, right?
Yeah, we did. Let's see.
Safe routes to school and the financial management structure.
Yeah. You're actually allowed three in that program, so we could take something on to that nature. They explained it in its entirety at the Selectmen Association meeting.
I recommend that we take a look at that.
It looks favorably in the budget, but everything's on the table for cuts.
Yep.
Because a shortfall this year, $370 million, and projected $750 million for 17 budget for the state. So everything's on the table. The speaker and the governor are saying probably no new taxes, but Senator Rosenberg says new taxes have to remain on the table because it's going to affect education, transportation, and infrastructure. So
let's redirect our community compact money and look towards identifying IT as a identity.
But I don't want to just wholesale give up on the financial because that's critical. But if we can find out if there's any way for us to get into the IT grant,
as Donald
as well.
Had said, yeah. If you're available for three different, and we applied for two, let's get the third one on it.
And I do believe within the IT, within the community compact grant, there are two options. One is for infrastructure, and one is for consulting. So since you've really completed the consulting piece here, you should be able to move on to the infrastructure portion.
And I think at the time we applied for the community compact grant, we'd already contracted with you for the consulting, and not having the outcome, we didn't apply for the infrastructure piece, so we can readdress that.
The way I understood it from the speaker, if you have three, you get more grant points for the following year, so it would behoove us probably to take on the third.
Okay, we'll see what we can do. So I suspect you'll be hearing more from us.
Okay.
Appreciate all the work that you did.
Thank you.
Okay. And anybody else have anything?
No. No.
Thank you.
As long as we've got this already set, I don't see why you wouldn't throw it in front of them exactly.
We've addressed some low-hanging fruit already.
Yeah.
So, yeah, a lot more to come.
There's a lot more to come. And you can choose to do it in piecemeal. Or, you know, you could get some, you know, funding together and take a big whack at most of it.
So again, as we're heading into our planning, that's kind of, we need to know what needs to go in the capital plan.
To Jerry's point, maybe if you could get some numbers, some solid numbers on your one red, yellow, 1, 2, 3, 4, or whatever.
I think there was an attachment, isn't there?
Yeah,
there's an attachment.
Yeah.
Spreadsheet that
I didn't
have
but there's a
out.
Spreadsheet.
And again, we had to do ranges because we don't know, you know, exactly what's in
there. And again, that's going to boil down to exact decisions on some of the subsets. It has to be decided.
Yeah.
I mean, because everything's going to be arranged until we actually get down to the nitty gritty.
Yes.
No, but I mean, as far as if we're able to put an X amount of dollars in that grant money where we could do one, two, and three.
Yeah, there is a list that has all the.
It's in the email attachment.
Okay.
Appendix, or is it under?
Yeah, there was an appendix, right? The appendices that came with the.
Correct, yes.
That's where it is?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
It's in the original email. I don't think it made it into tonight's material, but, yeah. I've got it in an email, can forward it. Okay, so the next thing is on us, then. We need to figure out how to get to that decision point. Yep, so that we can look for the funding.
Okay.
Okay, thanks very much. Appreciate it. Let's see, can we do the code of conduct first, and then we'll move on to by North Hadley? Okay. So any thoughts, questions, concerns, comments about the code of conduct?
Make the motion to accept as written the select board's code of conduct for the town of Hadley.
Second.
Okay, motion made and seconded. Any discussion?
I would like to know where it differs from the code of ethics and guidelines for international city, county, and management associations, which we are supposed to adhere to anyways. It seems like it's very repetitious of everything, and we spent an awful lot of time creating this board of ethics for us, and it's actually just duplication of everything we have already, and it seems like we wasted a lot of time on this.
I think it's far more specific than the general one is in the selectmen's menu.
This is specified for us.
I don't know. I'd like to know what the objectives are from the chairman on this.
Sure. Yeah, I'd be happy
to share. Just a little refresher.
Yep.
I've gone through and I've got a lot of questions, and I don't want to start asking question after question, but maybe you could help me.
First of all, it's considered a best practice. So, you know, in conversations and training that I've been to in the past, one of the first things that the Mass Selectmen's Association recommends is that each municipality adopt a code of conduct for their select board. And they actually suggest that expand beyond select board. I mean, there are many boards in town that every board should have this. And it's one thing to say that, you know, we're supposed to adhere to the ICMA rules, but you know, the likelihood that people have brought that home and curled up with it at night before bedtime is probably not high. So I think, you know, again, different towns function in different ways. There are different forms of government. Some have strong town administrators, some have weaker town administrators, some have town managers. So the recommendation is that each municipality adopt it for the manner in which they choose to do business. And to the point about specificity, I think many people can read kind of a general suggestion and interpret it in different ways. So a lot of the impetus behind coming up with a code of conduct that would work for us was to make sure that the select board is acknowledging that we understand our role. I mean, we're the policy makers, but we're not, you know, operational management. To make sure that appropriate boundary lines are drawn between the select board and municipal employees, to make sure that the lines of communication are clear, to make sure that, you know, clearly, as you pointed out, Donald, I mean, the underlying thrust of a lot of this does have to do with ethics. You know, we all have to take that ethics test every couple of years, but again, it's spelling out in there in plain sight, you know, exactly what that means in terms of the possibility of conflict of interest, having conversations where somebody may perceive that we're representing the select board when we're only representing a personal opinion. So, I mean, there's a lot of meat to that, and I thought it was very important as the chair to bring that to the committee because it's not something that Hadley's adopted before, and I feel that we're really behind the eight ball in that regard.
I guess the only other question I can ask is, say if there is an infraction, mm-hmm. how is it going to be enforced to recommend the infraction? Are we just going to refer it back to the Ethics Commission and let them deal with it?
Well, I mean, I think it depends on the nature of the infraction. I mean, I would think that if any one of us was behaving or acting in a manner that wasn't conducive with the code of conduct, that you know, there should be a conversation amongst peers, you know, first and foremost, to, because, you know, my opinion of the code may be different from yours and Joyce's. So I think that, you know, first of all, the typical resolution, you try to fix it in-house first, and then if it is an ongoing problem, then it may become more public. You know, if anybody wants to drop a dime on the Ethics Commission, that's their purview. If something rose to that level, which I would hope it wouldn't, but...
So you're saying it may become verbal initially, and then it may become a written infraction by the board?
Yeah, well, again, I think it depends on the nature of it.
I agree, too.
I mean, you know, if somebody's clearly violating ethics, I mean, that's kind of a hop, skip, and a jump, probably right over our group somewhere else. But if, you know, if there's certain behavior with town employees that, you know, people think lines are being crossed or whatever, then that's going to beg a conversation from the board.
I think that's the chairman's responsibility to correct that situation.
I concur.
Speak to the members and say, listen, I have this problem with an employee. Can we rectify it immediately, talk about it, and solve the problem?
Yeah, and I think that's the first step. Like we said, there's a conversation amongst peers first. Because again, the chair's an administrative head, but I have no more real authority than anybody else up here. I'm just one vote. But yes, I mean, I would think it would start with the chair of the committee to have a conversation privately and see if it can be resolved. I mean, that just seems like good form, if nothing else.
I gotta agree with Don. The amount of time that we wasted on this thing, and I got you on both Ethics Commission and Boston Law numbers. I got them right here. I've been using them for the last 4 years because of the conflicts I am with this board. And we're bound under that law, and that's it. No so, matter what else you put in writing here, which really. You don't have the chapter and sections of laws on any of these paragraphs, which do pertain to them. I don't see any need for it at all.
So we have a motion made and seconded. Is there any further discussion on this? I mean, we've had it in front of us for 3 meetings now, so I don't necessarily feel the need to delay it any further.
No, go for it.
Okay, so put it to a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
No.
No.
Okay, so 3-2 vote to adopt the code of conduct. Okay. Can we jump to North Hadley Fire Station Ad Hoc Committee? So I believe this agenda item was put on at the request of the North Hadley Fire Station Ad Hoc Committee. Okay. So David, do you have something to say, or do we want to turn it over to...
I believe Mr. Michkowski may have a report for us. In particular, he's concerned about having a joint presentation with the Zoning Board of Appeals in order to get a variance for both the lots that are being proposed, for the northernmost lot being for the fire substation and for the second lot to the south for the property and 50 feet of parking. Is that correct?
Yeah. It has to go in front of the ZBA, and I'm asking the board if you want us to fill out the application, the chairman signs it on behalf of the town, so we can lay out our entire project, and also the North Hadley Hall with Mr. Greenbaum goes in prior to us with his project, because they both are working together here on that site, because the town, in fact, is making both of these lots non-conforming. We ended up with a building 100 by 65 that lot can give, with parking on the north side, parking to the pond side, and parking right in back of the building for personnel, and a road driveway right completely around that with a 50-foot offset. So that Board of Appeals would determine the property line, the 50-foot offset that Mr. Greenbaum requested, and to make his parking work with his project there. And that whole project is gonna come under that MS4 water, but that will be done later. The biggest thing is the variance. The variance don't happen, nothing happens. So we gotta go through that hurdle first. And I'm asking the board if you want us to lay out the project on the application and the chairman, because it is town property, chairman of the board of selectmen signed that, and we'll pick up a date. Soon as you do the contract or the agreement with Mr. Greenbaum, and I guess it's gonna be contingent upon that ZBA ruling. Otherwise. Well,
that's what I was gonna say, Jen. We haven't finished our negotiations yet with Mr. Greenbaum. So we're still.
How far out are you on that?
We're in the process of discussing that for February 13th. Not February.
I was just saying, what?
Well, how about, wow, July 13th. We'll all be in the dead of winter here. July 13th.
Yeah, because it's gonna take like a couple weeks.
Yeah.
You know, to set up for a hearing, so I don't know if we could work together.
What time?
We need 4 weeks.
4 weeks for hearing? Like 4 weeks lead time?
Yes.
I think one of the questions that the ZBA will have is the configuration of the building that's being proposed on that northern lot. Has your committee settled on a configuration of parking, setback, building location, building size? Or is that still something that's being done?
We have all that. It's now with the chief, the police chief and the fire chief to actually lay out the building. Here's what we got, where the doors, where this is. We got all the parking laid out to the north side,
yeah.
Church side, to the lake side, and the location of the building.
Mm-hmm.
And now it's in their hands to set what actual uses they want to have inside that building.
So we
got a tentative meeting for July 14th to put that together.
Did this coincide with Greenbaum's idea of what he's purchasing there?
Right.
It does.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think it's imperative that the two go together for.
Absolutely.
I couldn't agree more.
The building of the hall to accomplish Mr. Greenbaum's goals, he has to have special zoning, just like we're gonna need it for that site also.
Right.
And if he doesn't get the zoning properly, he can't go ahead with his project either.
Right.
So it's imperative both get voted on back to back at a ZBA and planning board meeting.
Right. I would think if Mr. Greenbaum's variance failed, then I don't think the board would have any other choice but to demolish that building.
Reject a bid.
You know.
So do we need to actually?
I should vote for that one.
So the question before us this evening is whether or not we'd like your committee to bring forth that to the ZBA, or whether we should bring that before the ZBA?
Well, we have the whole plan, so it really would just have the chairman sign it on behalf of the town.
So the question is also, should your committee draft
right
the information?
But if you figure you can handle your thing in 2 weeks, then we could put that together, because it's 4 weeks out to do that.
Yes.
So we will put that application in, and meanwhile, you do what you got to do to bind your end. Now that that map that Randy did, there's the fixed boundary. There, it's there. You know, the ways and bounds are there. So that can be your map. You have a copy. I left a copy with David.
Initially, the Historical Commission approved this site, but then they said other sites were possibly coming in. Have we received any other proposals of land for this site for a fire station?
So you have two RFPs out for land right now that are being advertised, one for the north end of town, one for the center of town. Both of those are due back on July 29th.
So the first select board meeting in August would be the chance for you to take a look at those.
My comment to that, I think if you put those two on the table at town meeting, they both will fail. Already, the town did vote to reject a partial specifically for fire and park and rec. The last town meeting rejected that. If you go back again, I think the people are going to be really upset about it, and you're going to lose everything and put everything backwards. You know, and this, I know the planning board will not stand alone and allow that to have apartments there. That would fail. You'll lose that out. So it's just going to make a royal mess of it.
Well, just dealing with what's in front of us tonight, I mean, I agree with the everybody else. It seems to make sense that it would be a common effort to affect that. So I don't know, do we need to take a vote, or are we just agreeing that, yes, please go forth? And
I would ask you to take a vote for the record. That way, you know, we're going to draft it. We'll put it together because we got what we want to put in there, and on behalf of the town, the chairman sign it.
Okay, somebody want to make a motion to that effect?
I'll make a motion to that effect to have the North Hadley Fire Station Ad Hoc Committee put together a plan to present to the Zoning Board of Appeals and present it to Ms. Keegan so that she can sign it.
I'll second that motion.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. All right. Public safety complex roof replacement project.
Okay.
Finally.
So we went out to bid for the public safety complex roof. We received 6 bids in. The low bidder, the low bid started at $240,000 even. And the high bid was $322,000.
How much we have available?
We have available for this project
$205,000.
And we have an additional pot of money for municipal buildings with a balance of $92,507. So if we transfer $47,000 from that, leaving half that amount left, $45,000. If we transfer $47,000, which would include a 5% contingency for the project, we'd have a project budget of $252,000 for the low bidder, which would be $240,000. Spent a lot of time talking about the low bidder, Supreme Systems, comparing it to DP Kearney Incorporated, going through references, checking information, looking over the bid specifications, looking at the kinds of controls and warranties that we have in our contracts and our specifications, so the performance bonds and the contractual liabilities. We have a company that has a Texas-based parent that's been in business from 1987. There's a New England branch which opened in 2012. The company in general has done many standing seam metal roofs, but not in New England. So, you know, it's a judgment call. You've got a bid that exceeds your available budget, although you can supplement it in order to meet that price, plus a contingency, and you have a company that on paper meets all the qualifications for the bid. So playing it by the numbers, if you're willing to make the transfer, Supreme Systems Incorporated is the low bidder.
I guess my question would be to the fire chief and police chief, are you satisfied with the low bidder and the job that they can do for the town of Hadley or not?
You haven't done any research on that, have you?
I don't know their company, no.
No.
I don't either.
We can nail them to the whatever. tower down there if they don't do a good job.
I think we're significantly over. It's my humble opinion, and I'm going to make a motion, that we reject the bids and ask it to go out to bid again.
Why is that?
Because we're $40,000 over budget. And the company that's the low bidder on this has got less than 5 years' experience in the business of putting in standing seam roofs. I just think that we're way over budget on that, and I think that we should tell them that we're way over budget and ask them to rebid these things. Also, I understand that there is an adjustment that can be made to the bid process, which potentially could save $20,000 off the spec on what's going out.
What's the adjustment to the bid process?
Tim? Underlayment.
Yes. A couple things, if I may. I'd like to reiterate the issue that Jerry brought up. The company's been around for 4 years, and what David just said, they haven't done a standing seam metal roof in New England yet. I think it would be a big difference if we were talking about something as simple as the DPW roof that's straight shot. This is a little different. It's very complex. Standing seam roofs are a bit of an art form. I'd hate to be the first one for them to practice on us. They might be the best, but we don't have that in front of us. The other issue with Jerry brought up is, unfortunately, I did not catch something that got modified and got flipped several times in the specs. One of the things we can save some money, because the one thing I did not catch at the end on the final version, that the underlayment that was specified in the specifications is not the correct underlayment. We can save ourselves some money going to the correct underlayment for a metal roof. What unfortunately was in the specs at the last time when it went out, and the problem was there was a lot of revisions on this thing with the architect, and we just didn't catch it. What was spec'd was what normally everybody calls stick and deal. And what did you put under asphalt roofing? It's not what you want under a metal roof, especially a standing seam roof, because that standing seam roof has to be able to expand and contract and remove. The proper type of underlayment is a thicker product that's not adhered by adhesive that's put on the sheathing, and it allows some movement there. The nice thing about the underlayment that's supposed to be there is it's cheaper because of the adhesive is what's expensive for the film stick. So David and I talked at length about this and how we could handle it after we found out that it was the wrong product, and it was brought up by a couple of the roofers. And unfortunately, because of time, we ran out of, we could have put an addendum out immediately, but we ran out of time, and we talked about it and said, let's see what the bids are, and then we could probably do it as a change.
Well, that's what I was wondering why we didn't put an addendum so everybody had the opportunity to.
Well, we just ran out of time. It was basically by the time we got to it, it was the morning of.
So, and I'm sorry, but so what was the process when the spec, you said the architect put the specs together?
The architect, yeah, yes. We worked
It's just
off,
been a while, so I'm trying to remember.
It's been a long process.
Yeah.
We had specs written up for all the other roofs.
And this was the Municipal Building Committee?
Correct.
Okay.
Because of this being substantially over $100,000, it goes into DCAM.
Of course.
There's a huge amount of upfront specifications requirements that are needed for the DCAM type of process. Mm-hmm. We don't have the expertise in-house to do it. That's why we hired the architect. He put together that, and he took the old specs from the other roofs and milled it into the DCAM specs. But there was one of the things that we found right up front was the underlayment, because most of the roofs are asphalt. Mm-hmm. it was taken out, the proper thing was put in, but unfortunately, it was a lot of other stuff that was being changed back and forth. We had too many drafts going back and forth, and unfortunately, I did not read every single line, and I did not see that the last draft that we okayed had the improper underlayment on it.
So if we reject all of the bids and we go back out to bid again, what time frame are we looking at now?
Well, we'd have to redesign the roof.
The underlayment, not the roof.
Well, the specifications, this is from the architect that we're very unhappy for because of non-performance. I'm thinking you're delaying this by 6 months.
Oh, brother.
Yeah.
This is getting ridiculous.
So there's a couple of things that we need to have on the table. First of all, you know, we raised $150,000 for this project. We realized that it was going to be insufficient, so we went back to the voters, and they were good enough to give us another 55 to bring us up to 205. The bids are coming in higher than that. You know, I think the voters have expressed their confidence twice. We need to respect the will of the voters. The second thing is in the bid specifications, there's a pre-installation meeting and conference that we would have with the contractor, by which we would review the materials, review the installation plan, review all the ins and outs, the nuts and bolts of putting the roof on the building properly. So we have a lot of control over the process.
But can we change this, and tell them if we accepted the low bid, that can we go back and say we don't want that underlayment, we want a cheaper one?
Through a change order.
Through a change
okay.
order.
Yes.
Okay.
Which costs money.
Well, no, but we
change
the
change order costs money.
But the change order would be to reduce the price of the contract because it would be less expensive material.
Yeah.
You can do a change order down as well as up.
I think if we went to another redesign and an architect, the amount of money we'd be saving with the underlayment would be lost to the new design, what it's going to cost us to do that. I don't know how close the figures are, but, and I can't see delaying this project 6 months because we're going to be into a whole new season. If we go ahead now, we're in an ideal situation for roofing. We're not going to be affected by winter months, you know, and they could do the job properly, I think.
So let me refine the 6 months because that's the figure that I just grabbed out of the air. So,
well, don't do that.
Well, I mean, take us a month to regroup, take us a month to bid it out, take us a month to award the contract, and get all the contracts flowing.
All right. So that's October 1st.
Yeah. So I mean,
September 1st.
Call it 4 months, not six.
No, the month of July, a month to
August.
Get all the bids back.
This year, because it's November 1st.
October 1st.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
Am I hearing this right now? You're going to award a contractor that the guy can't show you this is the first he did in New England? I think this is totally ridiculous, especially on a standing seam roof like Tim Neihardt said.
What I heard is that this is a national concern. They're based out of Texas, that the local franchise of the local, you know.
Sometimes those guys are the worst guys. Jerry knows he hit the nail on the head with that. I think you guys
made a mistake
by doing that.
Texas has got a little different weather than Western Massachusetts, I hate to tell you.
Well, we also need to be, the state procurement laws exist for a reason, and I'm reluctant to throw everything back out to bid. I mean, again, this, as David said, they're in this contract, there are stipulations and there are checkpoints all along the way that the contractor has to adhere to.
Not one of you are experts in anything.
No, but that's why we have a building inspector who watches over these things, too.
I think if we do, my suggestion, if we do go with Supreme, mm-hmm. we need to get
a professional in here to review it, because I don't know the ins and outs of standing seam roofs either.
But we would be saying that then for anybody installing a standing seam roof, because why would you give one guy?
If somebody's got 10 years of experience with names that are for references versus no experience at all.
This would be the first project manager job, right? That would be representing the town of Hadley when we hire the project manager?
You're talking about the OPM?
Yeah.
No, design's already been done.
No, because they wouldn't have been, they wouldn't be involved in this.
Throw them all out, change the underlayment.
So whose response is going to lie with Tim, all the responsibility to make sure the job is done completely right?
They could probably still have it up by October.
Or would we have another advisor helping you?
I would, you know, if we do go with Supreme, I certainly would, we should get somebody.
I think we should too.
And which we can easily do. I mean, this, it's a really, you know, it's going to be a flip of the coin. This guy might come in and say, because this is my first roof, I'm going to do the best job ever I can. And, but then again, it is an art form, so he can screw it up.
$240,000 is a pretty big coin, Mr. Building Inspector.
I think he's agreeing with you.
So.
Gary, do you want to?
They have to have a sheet metal license. Did you check to see if any of them, anybody in that company has?
Next bid is how much?
I did not check on the sheet metal license.
Next bid is how much more?
Next bid is $3,104 more.
But then if you go to the next bidder, you have to have a bona fide reason why you're not taking the low bidder. And that really opens up a can of worms too.
Which is why my
procurement procedure.
Which is why my motion on the floor has nothing to do with anybody at all, but to go back out with the right underlayment and get the numbers back after you tell them that everybody's $45,000 over.
That's the safest way to go.
I just don't like the time element. It's pushing us too far along, and I don't think we can wait that long.
I don't think 6 months is a realistic number.
Plenty of time.
So, motion on the floor.
I just want to ask, so we've got other members of the Municipal Building Committee here. I know that I was hearing, boy, I hope you guys are going to vote on this roof so we can get going, and now I'm hearing we don't care so much, so I'm just wondering what it is.
Well, I want to see a standing seamless roof, but I also don't want to see...
Sure, you don't want crap.
Yeah. I believe this. I think the specs, I'm sure, said 5 years of experience doing it, and like David says, the company's had it, but it's kind of an offshoot of when I went online, you know. So I mean, I don't know if it's like a franchise or what, but kind of, technically I guess it's covered, but, you know.
I'm sure they're going to be sending advisors from Texas to work with these people, to cover them, no doubt.
Why keep them in Texas?
Why would they do that? They give a guy a franchise.
I don't know if it's a franchise or... how it works, but it's a, you know,
it's a division.
Newer company.
Just a division of them.
So there we are. We don't have enough budget unless we transfer the money. We don't have a reason to reject the low bidder because on paper they make all the they meet all the qualifications.
If they have their licenses.
And they're over budget by $35,000.
Along with everybody else.
Yeah.
Correct. I'm not specifying anybody else gets the bid.
That's exactly the point. And I'll second Jerry's motion just the way he said it like that. It's we're rejecting them all because they're all over. That's it.
And adjust the underlayment for the proper underlayment for the second bid.
I'm not happy about it, but I'd rather have it done right than not done right.
I absolutely want to have it done right.
But I'm not happy with this process.
I'll echo the I'm not happy about it.
Well, the elementary school field's big enough. Their roof will land right in there.
What? Prevailing wind used to go the other way.
Oh,
he means I second the motion.
No, it's going over across the street.
All right, somebody want to make a motion, one way or the other?
The motion's been made and seconded.
Oh, was it made and seconded?
Yeah.
I missed that. Oh, you, that's what you're saying, he's seconding the motion, okay.
On the playground.
Can I ask one more question before we go?
Sure, absolutely.
The present roof isn't leaking, is causing any kind of problems or anything. Can we extend the deadline on this project?
Well, I mean, we had, it depends on what goes on this year, but we usually use a, lose a few shingles during the summer. And they can be filled in and like we've done in the past, so I mean, we can keep them leaking.
Didn't we just have a contractor go up and repair that whole roof a little bit to prolong its life?
That was last year or 2 years ago.
Yeah, we do.
I've repaired it before.
Yeah, we do fix this every year. I've crawled through crawl spaces myself to break up ice dams.
And I agree with Selectman Chungalo. I want it done right too.
I would agree.
I agree.
You know, I think she's made a good point.
I mean, the architect doesn't have to do a lot of correcting. He's got to change basically one or two lines to put it back out. Hopefully.
All right.
The price drops by 20,000.
Okay, put it to a vote, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed?
Oh, I'm sorry, opposed?
I didn't hear you.
Oh, I said aye.
Oh.
Okay, well, let's watch this one really closely as it goes through the next phase here, because this is a bit much, honestly.
It is.
Yeah.
Should that happen?
Next.
Okay, next, OPM, Owner's Project Manager. So want to thank, find my notes on the thing. Want to thank the folks that participated in the OPM subcommittee. So we had Dan Regish, Dave Biskevitz, Ginger Goldsberry. Chief. Mike Spanknebel, myself, and who am I missing? Is there one other? Sorry, Andy Klepacki. So they were formulated for all of the individual kind of constituencies, if you will, who would be charged with working with this OPM going forward. We had, I believe, 7 or 8 applicants to the process. We wound up interviewing, calling 3 for final interviews after going through a ranking system. It is the unanimous recommendation of the OPM subcommittee that Colliers be put forth as the number one ranking from the group, D.A. Sullivan, number 2, and CMS, number 3.
How do you spell Colliers?
C-O-L-L-I-E-R-S. So generally, the rationale behind the ranking, I think some favor was given to both Colliers and D.A. Sullivan for the fact that both are local, well-known organizations. All 3 of them had significant experience with municipal construction. The individuals from Colliers, I think, probably did the best job interviewing in terms of demeanor, in terms of their ability to respond to questions. Colliers has an awful lot of breadth and depth in their staffing. So I think the thought was that, you know, as we get into this, we're not likely going to have to immediately start getting other opinions. There will be things that Colliers will be able to do within their own organization to give us kind of a quick sketch, if you will, of what direction we're heading in. And I think that the other respondents were more inclined to be looking to hire a third party to help them more immediately than Colliers. We like that, you know, and again, the reference checking was done by the subcommittee as well. So members of the subcommittee did reference checks, not only for the people who were listed as references, but also some of the projects that they listed where they didn't necessarily provide a name. And the Colliers references, they were all good, as you would expect. D.A. Sullivan's were strong, but Colliers were really just a lot of the language that was used around the interpersonal skills, the ability to kind of pivot. Oh, they're out of Agawam. You know, they, again, they have enough depth to provide a local team. We were very comfortable with that. So, again, in the ranking, you know, we didn't have an actual numbering system, but the visual was kind of like Colliers was here, felt DA Sullivan was here and CMS here.
What's the next step on this, to go under, to negotiate the contract?
Yep, the select board would either accept the recommendation based on the ranking from the subcommittee, or the select board could, in theory, conduct their own interviews. But if you accept the ranking, then the next step would be to move to negotiations with the OPM.
Based on the recommendation of the OPM selection committee, I make a motion that we accept Colliers and go into the next phase in the negotiation of the contract.
Second? Any further discussion? Anything else from the subcommittee members? You guys good?
Sounds great.
Okay. All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Yep, thank you for...
For your work.
Yeah, another subcommittee.
Just a clarification, so who's going to do the negotiation with the, with Colliers?
So, do we want to involve the municipal building committee in that process? Do we want to have a representative from the select board? Do you have a recommendation?
So we have a scope of work that is extensive, that was used as the request for qualifications for the OPM. We have a budget that's been raised by the voters. It's now just a matter of finding out how far into that scope of work the budget will carry us. That's the basis of the negotiations.
Mm-hmm.
So I think certainly the select board should be involved and a member of the municipal building committee.
Okay. Is there...
Do they have eight engineering capabilities as well?
Colliers?
Yeah. Does Colliers have engineering capabilities as well?
They had, I believe, if I, you can correct me if I'm wrong, I believe they had engineers and architects as part of the team.
Yeah, they had extensive.
Would the buildings committee entertain, because they're dissatisfied with the current engineering firm, the possibility of piggybacking this company with the OPM? Is that a conflict?
That's not what the OPM is there for. The OPM would help you to select a designer that would be appropriate for your projects, but wouldn't actually be doing the design themselves.
Yeah.
I think what Jerry's saying is, could you hire them to do that, like, separately?
Is there a conflict?
I think it might be a conflict.
Okay. Withdrawn.
It may not be, actually, but you would have to go through yet another procurement process to do that.
So, Jerry, just so you know, our thought process is to go to the second runner-up and see about utilizing that if we can get this worked out and how to get rid of
that. That's Sullivan's?
No, not with this, with the engineering firm there. Okay, so the committee would be, the complexity of the committee would be?
Select board member and somebody from?
Buildings committee?
Buildings committee.
Yeah, I mean, this is just going to be a one meeting negotiation. It's going to be very quick.
Okay.
There's currently a select board member on this committee, right?
Yeah, I'm happy to do it unless anybody wants to.
Would you continue on?
Sure, yeah.
That'd be fine with me.
Dan, you got experience with them.
Yeah.
And David Tudrin or Sue?
They'll make a recommendation from their committee. We would
hold off on that and have David Tudrin, if he would handle that.
Okay.
If we're qualified, then we are.
That sounds like a plan.
Make a motion that the makeup to the committee be a member of the select board, a member of the buildings committee, and the town administrator.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, good. So we have, we did have HPAT as an agenda item. We're passing over that tonight, just due to some scheduling and vacations and the like, so we'll take that up at another meeting. We have the ambulance committee. Okay, so just background here, at one point in time, we had an ambulance task force, it was called. And that committee was formed several years ago for the purposes of evaluating the current contract with Amherst, their performance kind of relative to that contract, whether or not it made sense to look at any other options for ambulance service. It was considered, first and foremost, a good practice because we had a contract with one entity for a very long time. And by and large, everyone's been very pleased with the service that Amherst has been providing. With that said, I think the impetus for that engagement was a slight increase that was suggested by Larry Schaefer, then town manager from Amherst, that was going to more than quadruple the amount that we were paying for the contract. So, but in the process of that, working with that task force, we looked at what it might like to completely outsource to an independent ambulance service, to contract with a municipality, either Amherst or another one that might be interested, maybe Northampton, that was proximate, that could provide services. And then also what it would look like to bring ambulance in-house. And at that point...
And another private entity, right? Would that was explored as well? Oh, I'm sorry.
Yep, so private entity, another municipality, shared services, and then in bringing it in-house. So the end result of that was we did wind up going ahead and signing another contract with Amherst, which we've enjoyed for the past few years. But I think collectively we've all agreed we're at that juncture where the Amherst itself has become quite strained in their ability to meet their own internal needs. And we are entering into another contract season, so we have one more year on this contract. But time to really get started if we're going to dig into this again. So the conversation tonight is about the resurrection of the ambulance committee. Mike, did you want to chime in?
I was asked to just speak with some folks that I guess had showed some interest that was presented to me. I hadn't heard from anybody else, but Hank Barstow has offered to sit on that committee if you so choose. Molly and Joyce, I didn't hear anything different that you wanted to leave that committee. Stephen Barstow, he's a captain on the fire department, Stephen Barstow the second, so the younger son, has requested to be on the committee. And that's all we have at this point. We felt it would be more important because of all the information that we have already, would be to form more of a working group rather than another study committee, where we could revise the numbers and kind of dig deeper into the source of potential revenue to the town and how it might support other departments, the fire department, and how we might be able to proceed with that with support from either private ambulance services or municipalities. So that's what we were hoping to do with resurrecting this working group.
Is there possibly anybody from the last ambulance committee that possibly would volunteer to serve on this one? Because I'm sure they would have a wealth of information.
The other two members, I was told by Molly, I don't believe Brian Glazier wants to continue, is happy with Hank Barstow taking his position.
I didn't talk to Brian, just saying no.
That's what I got from,
so we could reach
Hank. So we could reach out to him, but he said he was, from what Hank told me, that Brian said, I'm glad you would be taking over from me. The only other person on the committee, I believe, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, was George Moriarty, and I have not reached out to him.
A possible other one would be Barbara O'Connor used to be a select board member. The last two colleges, she retired just last week from her position at UConn. The last two positions she's had, she's overseen the fire departments as part of her safety information. And I know she used to be a selectman and was an integral part of the community.
She was actually on, I believe, the
original
first 3 year, and then she had taken her position.
Well, because she was in Illinois and then in Connecticut, but now as of possibly with in her retirement, maybe she'd be interested.
May have come on when she rolled off.
You just won't let people retire.
No. She's got a vast knowledge of it, and I think it'd be, from an administrative aspect.
You haven't asked her yet.
I haven't. I just...
Why don't we look to the public or anybody interested in it?
Great idea.
The biggest thing I wanted you to understand, and it's totally up to you, but it was more to have a working group than a full committee again. Because, again, we've done... Joyce has done 9 years' worth of ambulance study. I've done 6. So we have a really extensive foundation for this. So we don't feel, it's my opinion, and it's, again, it's up to you, but I feel that we're past the study portion and we're into the fact finding and getting you some hard figures and the source of revenue costs, what these potential revenues could be, and the potential impacts it would have to your fire department and kind of leveling the cost for that service. So that's my opinion.
Because it needs to be done in phases, as we know. Correct. So it's not anything that's just gonna jump right into, but we're gonna have to do something where it's gonna be steps to get where we want it to be, and it's not gonna be right away, but it's, you've gotta start somewhere.
Yeah, and we always get public input once, you know, the information comes forward to the select board anyway, so. Yeah, I agree, I mean, just having sat on the committee, that is a pretty steep learning curve, so.
We have support from local chiefs around us who are all willing to step up again with their support and information on, from the startup to what they're dealing with operations from a smaller size ambulance service. For example, West Hampton, the fire chief has spoken multiple times, he created his own ambulance service through the fire department, to Chief Anderson, who was the Granby fire chief, is now Southwick, has extensive knowledge in that, he's willing to be kind of in the advisory role for us on it.
Southampton, a little town like that, has two ambulances.
Correct.
That they service.
And the Southampton chief actually did come in and interview with us during the second. So we've had a lot of really good information, and again, we have private ambulance services that are willing to come in as well.
No, I'd be happy if Barbara O'Connor was willing, I'd be more than happy to have her participate. She's been a select board member and obviously has a wealth of experience too.
And I have no idea, I didn't ask, I mean, wasn't the venue to ask, but
throwing her name out.
I just thought that it would be, you know.
She's saying, Jerry, she's sitting at home right now.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's the only one.
You better wait till her up there.
That's what I'm saying, you know, there are other people out there that may have more experience than 3 or 6 years that have been on an ambulance for, who knows, 30 years. You've been in a hospital for how long?
She worked on Jesus.
And I didn't say the
tone. That's all I'm saying, see what's out there.
Yeah. He did rise.
Well, I mean, if anybody, you know, if anybody's dying to be in, I don't know, there was someone else in town that had expressed an interest a few years back, but now happens to be employed by one of the organizations that we'd likely be interviewing anyway, so that wouldn't make sense to have him on the committee. But certainly if anybody's in
need. He's offered us lots of knowledge. Tom
exactly.
Valentine.
Tom Valentini.
Valentini, yes. Valentino. Valentine.
Yep. Okay. But I agree with Mike. I mean, I think this is a let's roll up the sleeves and get the numbers up to date for everybody. So if there's somebody that can, you know, comes to the forefront, John, that can, you know, be useful in that regard, certainly.
All right. So
okay. So, do we need a motion on this, or can we just?
I said so.
Oh, okay. Second?
What was the motion? What are we moving?
Yeah, she
didn't. Forming the committee and working committee.
So moved. Second, I mean. I will second that motion.
Okay. So, can I just ask, you want me to reach out to Barbara and ask her if
sure.
she's willing?
Sure. Okay.
Is that okay? Or did you want to do that, Jerry?
Nope.
He knows that.
You could throw me right under the bus.
Patrick gets back up with me.
And tell that Jerry Devine.
Okay, goals and objectives update?
We need to vote.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. Let's see. Yeah, let's chatter around. Okay, all in favor?
Hello, yes. Before we do goals and objectives, can we go back to his weekly report and then go into goals and objectives?
We can.
Because we skipped over it.
Yeah, I was just doing that in the spirit of time, figuring we could cover that at the end. But,
okay, it's up to you. Okay, I didn't know what you were doing.
Okay. David, do you want to hit the highlights before we go into goals and objectives?
Are we doing the weekly report? Okay, so. An update on the Bay Road Bridge. I did talk to MassDOT about the progress towards getting that project completed. They have finished their investigation into the deterioration of the support structures. They've submitted that to their design people and their construction people. They're going to kick it around the channels that they have to, and then they'll bring it back. So I thought this project would be done in July and August with a completion date early September. Not entirely sure that that's going to hold now, so that's an update there. Marlo did a great job on the Route 9 widening project, so I won't spend time on that. The HVAC control project is noticed to proceed has been issued. contractor has 90 days to complete the project, and you'll have the contract documents to execute at your next meeting. Jumping down.
We already did the roof.
We did the roof, you did all the other things that we've already talked about. Under the fiscal year, we're making sure that we're adhering to the internal deadlines for closing out the books for FY16 and starting up the FY17.
Oh, and David, just on that note, kudos to the collector's office, but most importantly, the taxpayers.
Yes, absolutely.
For paying their bills, so we're having a really good.
The lowest number ever.
Ever.
And that.
So the number that we're talking about is the amount of uncollected taxes at the end of the fiscal year. Every dollar of uncollected taxes is a deduction off of our free cash. Susan Glowatsky and Kim Pfeiffer have been working very hard in order to bring the amount of our collected taxes below 100,000. They almost did it a couple of years ago. They did it for the first time last year, and now they've reached a new low, which is a good thing.
It's a new low.
Of $84,000 of uncollected taxes remaining. So this is good for our free cash. It's good for our revenues. And it's a very good trend. It also puts us at the very top of municipalities throughout the Commonwealth in terms of the lowest amount of uncollected taxes. So good work to them, and thank you very much to the taxpayers as well. The Massachusetts budget, Mr. Paczynski talked about this, is now being decided in a conference committee. Typically, that conference committee, which consists of three members of the Senate, three members of the House, in closed door sessions, no open meeting law here, no public records law here, hammer out the differences between the House and Senate budget, and when they do, they present that to the governor for signature. And their work is typically done by the end of June, and the governor has 10 days to review, and sometime around mid-July, he signs the budget and we get our final cherry sheet numbers. This year, because of a fall off of expected revenue, particularly having to do with capital gains tax, because of stock market volatility, and now I can say that this rogue Brexit affecting the future market capital gains projections, they're now looking at a significant funding gap between for their FY17 revenue projections. So they are going to take additional time. The governor and the Senate and the legislature have signed a temporary spending bill in order to fund the state government through July. And I expect that this conference committee will complete their work sometime in July with the governor signing everything in August. So that means our final cherry sheet numbers won't come due until August. I typically have them much earlier, so we'll have to wait. But it means cherry sheet numbers will fall into place pretty much at the same time as our free cash numbers. And then upcoming projects and events, we have the Independence Day fireworks, July 4th over at UMass at McGurk Stadium. Chicken to Go fundraiser for the Senior Center, pick up the tickets on July 10th. And then we have a special town meeting in the works for July, for October 27th.
Is it pick up the tickets or the?
Chicken.
Chicken.
I'm sorry, chicken. Did I say tickets?
Yeah,
chicken.
You just want tickets, you know.
We'll talk a little more about that later.
My mistake. check out the sign in front of the Senior Center. We'll set you straight.
There you go.
Yes, sir.
I got a question. Is there going to be any discussion on that medical marijuana?
Tonight?
Because we get a vote coming up whether to approve it or disapprove it. And I have an issue with the fundraiser on it, or the charitable organization.
That was part of the consent agenda?
Yeah.
And what we voted on the consent agenda was we've asked the chief of police to recommend to the board.
I just like to make a comment. Ain't the police chief that's going to vote on it, either the selectman or the vote on it, it's going to be the planning board to either accept it or not accept it, and that's going to be in reality.
Well, what's in front of the planning board?
What?
What's in front of the planning board? You're talking about their overall proposal.
Medical marijuana, vote.
Right, but the select board, the negotiation for the impact agreement was with the select board.
That ain't gonna happen unless we vote for it.
Well, right, but so do you...
But I disagree about whether the police chief is gonna make a recommendation to give it to another community. This is the host community, and I asked, I talked to you about it, that the planning board pick out the charitable organization. I believe it belongs in this town. I believe it belongs to a resident in this town, whether it be a youth or an adult that's in addiction with drugs, because this is what this is all about.
You want, I'm sorry, I just want to make, so you're saying you want an individual to receive the charitable donation?
No, it could be for drug rehab, it could be for education of drugs in the school system, but to set an account, probably in control of the Board of Health, because this is where this whole thing is monitored from, is the state Board of Health, that our Board of Health could help an individual with this money set in that account. And I don't want to see it go to Northampton, I don't want to see it go to Greenfield, Springfield, or any other town. And believe me, I'm not gonna vote for it if that happens.
Okay, but again, just to kind of separation of duties here, the impact agreement was negotiated on behalf of the town by the select board.
That's okay.
Right, and we negotiated a charitable annual contribution with the organization.
But you don't get a chance to vote it.
If they get up and running, so...
You don't get a chance to vote to make it happen. We do.
But, correct. So our only interest is in carrying out the document. Should they move forward with their business, that we will get to oversee, and we've, for that component of it, have merely asked for a suggestion from the chief of police. We haven't ceded authority to the chief of police, nor have we precluded anybody else from making a suggestion. But we're nowhere near at a point where we would, we're
well,
way in front of
the... Well, our
vote
is coming up the next meeting, so I'm gonna pass on that vote, because until you guys make your mind up, then I'm gonna make my mind up.
I'm honestly having trouble connecting the dots on the purview of the planning board.
I'm saying our next meeting is next Tuesday.
Yeah, no, I got that.
Right. So if I'm gonna just vote for something, and if it's gonna go to another town, I am not voting for that. It's in Hadley here, it's gonna be dealt with in Hadley.
But John, the planning board's not voting on the impact agreement. You're voting on whatever the merits are.
But you won't get no impact agreement if we vote no.
Well, vote the way you want.
Yeah, I mean...
We want to know what you're gonna vote. That's not gonna hinge on us on how we're gonna set our mind and what the police chief is gonna do.
For the planning board to decide where the charitable thing goes.
No, I completely disagree with that.
Okay, good. That's settled. No problem.
Do what you need to do.
Yeah, well...
I don't agree with it anyway, so fine with me if it fails. I don't care.
Yeah, more waste of time. If the state don't give them a permit, nobody's getting anything.
There's too many of them. There's too many in Hampshire County in this area now. We're being in flux with them enough.
You didn't get anything anyway.
Okay, Willie, you had a question?
Yeah, we gave the selectmen some information, the draft recommendations at the last meeting. Every board member had it.
For what?
Received the copy.
For the buildings?
The building recommendations, changes, and so on and so forth. Do you remember that?
Yeah, but what do you want us to do? We're not, that's not what's on the agenda right now.
What are we talking about?
Well, that's what I asked. We gave this to you. Is this something that we don't, that the fire department was taken away by the ad hoc committee? So right now, we're wondering whether the selectman wants us to continue working on placing the
senior
center,
library,
the park and rec, because the park and rec, once the fire department gets going, the park and rec on it. So what do you want us to work on now?
Right. Well, I think that what we were thinking was that we just the next step had been the OPM, so we've just agreed to go into contract negotiations with Colliers to become the OPM.
Yeah.
Our next select board meeting is July 13th, and in all likelihood, we'll be having the Municipal Building Committee back on the agenda for that meeting.
All right, that's fine, yeah, that's fine.
And it's 4th of July and all that stuff and vacation, so.
Yeah, I just.
We didn't forget about you. How could we forget about you?
I know, some would like to, but.
Okay, so then are we okay going into the goals and objectives now? David?
Okay, so this is information that you're receiving tonight for the first time, so I expect that you'll want to take everything under advisement, that's fine. Goals and objectives, first of all, the strategic plan, the Department of Revenue recommended that the select board develop a five-year strategic plan linking services provision with finances. The Board of Selectmen started that process by implementing the Municipal Building Committee, which has been doing a lot of good work in terms of the overall structures.
Are we going through this whole thing now?
No, he said you're taking under advisement. Go ahead. He's just recapping, right?
Right, I'm just recapping.
Just gonna highlight.
Yeah, I'm just hitting the highlights.
Right.
Okay. So last year, the select board asked the departments to develop these SWOT analysis, strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats for each department, as well as overall for the town. And we tried to incorporate as much of those SWOT analysis information into the FY17 budget. Unfortunately, because of the funding constraints that we experienced with the preparation of the FY17 budget, not all the expanded programs, many, in fact, most of the expanded programs that were identified in the SWOT were not entirely included in the annual town meeting budget. So now we're considering those expanded programs for the fall town meeting when our revenues picture is clarified. The board also produced a calendar of the actions to prepare the FY17 budget, and the calendar outlines the activities of the departments and the financial management team so as to provide the select board with information that they can use in order to develop their decisions. So working with the treasurer and working with the select board on the strategic plan, I intend in this year coming up to assist the board to incorporate further the SWOT analysis into development of the five-year strategic plan. Building on our experiences of preparing the FY17 budget, I intend to help implement the calendar for making the FY18 budget a much more inclusive process. I want to integrate the program expansion proposals into the revised FY17 budget for the special town meeting coming up on October 27th so that we can advance the programs and our service delivery. Working with the board, I'll implement the revised budget calendar that was prepared and adopted by the board in order to work into the into the October 27th special town meeting. Depending upon the release of the final cherry sheet numbers, I intend to produce a revised five-year budget forecast by September 1st, and then link the service delivery plan to the updated capital improvement plan in order to connect services, structures, equipment, and finances all together. And then finally to integrate the select board priorities into the FY18 preliminary budget by January 20th, 17. Getting my fiscal years and calendar years mixed up. Action plan is the second major area that I would like to address in my goals and objectives. Continuing to work with the financial management team in order to address the Department of Revenue financial management report, as well as the auditor's FY 14 and 15, when 15 becomes available, recommendations in terms of tightening up our finances. We are also working on implementing the best management practices regarding to our financial operations. And so when the Department of Revenue implements our Commonwealth Compact program to to develop a best management practice and organizational structure. I intend to be able to assist in that process as well as assist with the implementation. In addition, I've been working on a service delivery plan for the major departments, which I expect to present in early FY 2017. Service delivery plan outlines the primary functions, legal mandates, organizational structures supporting each department, and the plan identifies major projects or service targets with an eye towards strengthening departmental efforts to address some improved departmental effectiveness and align them with the Select Board's strategic goal. Service delivery plan is in draft form and is already proving useful in formulating strategic plans. Financial reporting, continuing using our beta and other formats in order to present information about the budget so that we have regular information having to do with town's financial condition, summary revenues and expenses, and other financial information to decision makers. The visual budget project, this is something that we started last year. And because of our transition from a staff accountant to a vendor accountant and the transition that that we needed to get up to speed on all of Hadley accounting matters as well as working through the audit and the FY16 year-end closeout, we haven't made much progress on the visual budget. And now that we have our transitional issues changed over, we're exploring how best to move this project forward. I would like to be able to implement this in the coming year. Personnel policies and wage studies, we're doing a final proofread of the personnel policies, so that should be presented to you very shortly. And working through the University of Massachusetts, we had an intern collect data from comparable communities having to do with personnel, salaries, and wage information. And we are organizing that data, and that should be presented to you in the next month or so. And then finally, this was suggested by the board to keep the Select Board and Town Administrator Office presentable with the move from one building to the other on the asbestos project. We were able to do a lot of work to clean out the office, make sure that old records that were no longer needed we could be disposed of, reorganize the information that we do have, and this is an ongoing project, and there's the constant vigilance to keep that office tidy.
We appreciate that vigilance.
Thank you.
It's a chore.
So the board may have questions, you may have some revisions.
Take under review.
Recommend that you take it under advisement.
Absolutely. And we had the fire chief out here tonight, but we're pushing that off. Okay. So we'll work with you on scheduling that, and then the same with our DPW director.
Okay.
Oh.
I'm ahead of the game. I turned mine in like a month ago. Here we go. Sorry.
All three of us are going the same.
West Street Common applications.
Yep.
I feel like competition.
So, use of West Street Common.
Make a motion we accept.
Second.
Any discussion on this?
There were some questions about the insurance requirements. We've addressed that. We've had it run past Maya, our insurance provider. I think we're all set to go.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
How is this going to conflict with the issue that we have with one particular business?
Nothing to do with it.
It's got nothing to do with it. This is a fee.
Why, if you post both sides of the common, no parking, you're not going to have any events out there.
You can post the common. It's not on the agenda this evening to post the common.
I'm just looking ahead a little bit.
Okay, we'll
keep
we'll
it
talk
in the back
that
of your mind.
To post the common?
Put it on the agenda.
Okay.
Okay, 2016 budget transfers.
Did we vote on it?
Huh?
We voted.
Yeah, we voted on
okay.
it. We all voted, and then John made that comment. 2016 budget transfers. Reserve fund transfers, David?
Right, so I'm just reporting in your board docs so that we have the reserve fund transfers that were approved by the finance committee. There's no action needed by the select board there, but for the spirit of disclosure, there it is. You have remaining in the reserve fund $38,500. We will need to come back and do additional transfers on July 13th because we're still in the end of the fiscal year. We're still catching up to some bills. But the line-to-line transfers, the finance committee approved two line-to-line transfers. The first one was for the highway budget, budget number 422, and a transfer from salaries to expenses of $10,000. The surplus was available because of the salaries because of the late hire of the DPW director, and the deficit in expenses. It's detailed in the attached memo that is on your board docs. The important thing is that there's no impact upon the bottom line for that budget 422.
Duly noted.
All right. Same with 450. We knew that we were going to have a problem with water. 450 because of the Chermara Road washout back in October. So again, this is a transfer from salaries to expenses of $10,000. Surplus is available in the salaries because of a hire of a new workforce, and deficit is explained in the attached memo. And again, there's no impact upon the bottom line. I recommend both transfers.
So moved.
Second?
I thought there was no.
Yeah, I thought you said there's no action.
I thought there was no action necessary.
There's no action necessary for the reserve fund transfers, but the line-to-line transfers require the board of the board.
Motion and second on the floor, Madam Chair.
Okay, yep. So all in favor of the line-to-line?
Aye.
Great. Okay, next we have personnel actions. We have longevity and then a change in job description. David?
Okay, so the first thing was that in the preparation of the FY17 budget, the select board and the finance committee agreed to give the non-union benefited non-contractual employees a longevity bonus. And so we've calculated that out based upon the longevity bonus that was available in effect at that time for the DPW. So for 10 years of service, $225, and for 15 years of service, $625. There's a budget of $6,200 based upon the elapse of time and the changes in personnel. You only need $5,900 in order to make that award. This is at this point a one-time only longevity payment. There's no expectation that'll happen in future years.
Okay. So moved.
Second? Is there a second?
Okay. I didn't want to third you.
Okay. All in favor of the longevity payments?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
Job description? Next.
Okay. So we've talked about we're very happy with Ms. Jennifer James's work here in the town of Hadley. We've talked about hiring her away from the temporary agency for whom she works right now and bringing her on as a permanent member of our team. But we also talked about the kinds of reorganization that needs to happen in the town administrator's office. We've talked about the kinds of work that I do that takes me away from other work that needs to get done. And in particular, the procurement is a large part of that. So right now, the position that is available downstairs is the administrative assistant licensing coordinator. I'm proposing that we change that to assistant procurement officer licensing coordinator. I've rewritten the job descriptions. The job description primarily changes only in a couple of places. First of all, then the second paragraph under the essential job functions, prepares, coordinates procurement, goods and services, design and engineering services, public construction, and public works. I've deleted the section that would require her to attend the select board meetings. She would still be preparing the minutes and taking a record of the major votes, but this would be done through the electronic media that we have available already. So we won't have Ms. James at our table, but she will be watching our every move.
What's the educational aspects of becoming a procurement, municipal procurement agent?
I'm glad that you asked me that, because going down to the knowledge, skills, and abilities part of it, the duties would require knowledge of Massachusetts general laws regarding relating to procurement of goods and services, public works, public construction, and design. The duties would also require knowledge of Massachusetts general laws relating to alcoholic beverage licensing, automobile dealer licensing, and other licensing under the jurisdiction of the select board. At a minimum, this means that Ms. James would have to read at several times probably the two chief procurement manuals having to do with goods and services and design and construction of public buildings and public works. This would be Chapter 30B, it would be Chapter 6, it would be Chapter 149, and Chapter 3039M would be the major procurement laws.
Is there a certification associated with it?
There is a certification that is optional. All right, so I have recommended that Ms. James go to the MCCPO training in Boston. This would be a significant investment in her training, but we would have her as a certified procurement officer on site who could assist with the procurement overall. I would remain as the chief procurement officer because of my training, but I think at some point we could see a changeover from me being chief procurement officer to somebody else being chief procurement officer, but I'm thinking that's years down the line.
Let's take the optional aspect out of that and make that a mandatory option for the position.
What,
the certification? That you become certified. Yeah, exactly.
That's a significant investment of money and time.
Yeah.
What are you talking?
I'm talking weeks of training at several thousand dollars. We can do that over a period of time.
Several thousand is how many? Five?
I don't have the fees in front of me, but I know that you're probably talking $3,000.
Let's make it full-blown. Let's absolutely get that online, and not as an option, as a mandatory aspect of the position. And it doesn't have to be today or tomorrow, but let's make that a mandatory aspect of the job within 6 months.
I've already started reading, and they haven't posted their new courses yet, just for the record.
You have to keep coming on Wednesday nights till you're certified. She'll have it in about 2 weeks.
Is she going to get a raise for all this?
Yes, and so that's the other part of this that we need to talk about is right now the administrative assistant licensing coordinator is at a grade 5. I propose to create a new position at grade 6. And you have on the back page the salary range there. I would recommend that we start her at $20.39 per hour. And then comparing the two budgets, the budget that we passed at annual town meeting was $37,076 for the old position, and the requested FY17 budget for the new position would be $39,914. That would be a difference of $28,038. That assumes that we start on July 1st. Ms. James and I have talked about a transition period where we would make this transition sometime in late July or early August. So it wouldn't be quite the gap, but we would have to make up that gap at the fall town meeting.
Discussion?
I would just personally like to thank her. We're both new, we came on board about the same time, and she helped me immensely. Rules have changed so much since I was a selectman before, and getting up to speed so I could operate properly, she was a real asset, and I thank her. Secondly, this position is very sensitive with the information that comes in. The information that she receives through faxes, telephone, is information that gets to her prior to our administrative assistant or us. And I don't like the idea of having a temp person in that position. I think we have to have a bona fide town employee in that position because of the sensitivity of the information that she has to handle.
Is that a motion?
Making a motion to approve, Donald?
I do. I make a motion to approve.
Second?
Second.
Okay. A motion made and seconded?
Can I have clarity as to when the we're going to have certification on that? Within 6 months?
I would say, in fairness, what's probably more comparable to the outside world. You know, I mean, unless you're the water treatment operator and you have to have is probably to allow for a year.
There's different levels of certification within the MCCPO program. I think we can hit the first level of certification in the first 6 months, and I can devote.
And that allows you to do what?
That would be goods and services.
Okay. Friendly amendment? Within 6 months?
Level one within 6 months.
And I'll make my professional development budget available for this purpose.
Yeah, can we talk about that? Okay.
So where is this coming into our $700,000 deficit?
Oh, you've got a lot to catch up on.
Oh, I've got a lot. I've got a lot to say.
Is a motion a second on the floor, Madam Chair?
So you guys don't even want to hear it, right?
I'm looking at you.
Go ahead. Take it to a vote.
Okay. All in favor? Aye.
No.
All right. And does that conclude our regular agenda for the evening? I believe it does.
Executive session.
Do we have any announcements?
I have two this evening, I guess, to the family of Mrs. Schwartz. Her son is John Schwartz that lives in town. Her passing, our condolences. And then to the family of Irene Bembem. She passed away today. Irene had been a lifelong resident of Hadley. Her family is Peter and Kathy, Peter's wife Jackie, and their two children. And she was superintendent of she worked for the superintendent of Hadley Public Schools, assistant town treasurer, library trustee, and as a registrar, she worked election worker for 2000 to 2015. So she will be sorely missed by many people in town. So our condolences to her family.
And also condolences to Richard Klein and his family and his extended family at Berkshire Design. We've done an awful lot of work with both Richard and his firm over the years, and quite saddened to hear of his recent passing as well. Anything else?
Hadley Senior Center wanted me to notify everybody that Sunday, July 10th, there'll be chicken to go at the American Legion between 11:30 and 1:30 in the afternoon. Advanced tickets are available at the Senior Center community for $8, and they're only selling tickets in advance. So please go down, see Susan or Mrs. Washkevitz. Get your tickets for Chicken to Go on July 10th between 11:30 and 1:30 in the afternoon. Tickets are $8.
And one final thing, we did receive a very nice letter from the folks over at Full of Grace Farm for a magnanimous rescue of a non-human being on the horse farm that was entrapped. So they were extremely appreciative of the fire department's efforts in that regard. Thank you again.
What did they do? One last thing, too. Madam Chair.
Say good luck to the Hadley Boy Scouts Troop 550. They're on their way to Philmont, New Mexico, for their for your annual trip.
Big trip.
It's going to be, yeah, quite a track for them, so good luck to you guys.
And we did receive a thank you letter from Mr. Boreska for bestowing the proclamation on him.
Yes.
And I can report, after watching the film, his brother said he was really uplifted. So it really meant a lot.
Okay, so we do have an executive session this evening.
I'll make a motion to go into executive session for the purpose, strategy to discuss collective bargaining and not to resume in open session.
Motion made. Is there a second?
Second.
This is for the dispatchers.
For the dispatchers, okay. So as chair of the Hadley Select Board, I state that the board is moving into, has moved and seconded to enter into executive session, and I state that discussing the matter in open session will have an adverse effect on the town of Hadley, and we will not be reconvening.
Good night.
Good night.
Leskovitz.
Leskovitz.
Yes.
Devine.
Yes.
Yeah.